Hi guys, it's Marc Zicree, Mr. Sci-Fi, also known as Marc Zicree of Space Command, and it's been a little while since I've done a Mr. Sci-Fi video because I have been busy. I've been we're working on the post-production phase of the first two-hour Space Command story. We shot a third of the second one. I've been writing the new edition of the Twilight Zone Companion and prepping hundreds of photos that have not appeared previously in the book or anywhere, many of them. Also, the Space Command novelization has been completed by Maya Bonhoff. I'm giving notes on that. And we're locking down managers and agents to sell Space Command, to get the meetings to sell Space Command as a TV series. Lots is going on, but that is not what this video is about. Because last Christmas Day, my dear friend George Clayton Johnson passed away. It was 91 years to the day that Rod Serling was born. And that's particularly meaningful because George Clayton Johnson, along with Rod, was one of the great writers of the Twilight Zone. He provided the stories that Rod adapted into the scripts for Execution and The Four of Us Are Dying. And he wrote the scripts for Nothing in the Dark, Kick the Can, Penny for Your Thoughts, and A Game of Pool. All great Twilight Zone episodes. In addition, he did the story for an episode called 90 Years Without Slumbering, but it was very, very different from the story that he initiated. But more than that, I just wanted to talk about my friendship and experience with George Clayton Johnson. He was a unique human being. Those of you who met him know exactly what I'm talking about. But I just wanted to kind of share some personal reminiscences and let you in on my private world of science fiction that has been so meaningful to me and so such a joy and has led me to where I am now. So let me talk to you about the first moment I encountered George Clayton Johnson's work. And it's a moment that many of you encountered his work for the first time as well. Now, when I was 10 years old, I was every bit as much of a science fiction fan as I am now. But certain things had not yet occurred. 2001, A Space Odyssey had not been made yet, had not come out. And there was one other event that had not yet occurred that would be, I think, at least artistically and creatively, the defining moment of my life. And basically it started when NBC was promoting the coming fall season and some of the shows that were coming back and some of the shows that were going to debut. And they hired an artist, a terrific artist named James Bama, to do four posters promoting some of the shows they had already on the air and some of the shows that were coming. And he did very nice posters for shows like Bonanza, and yet there was a new one. And basically what they would do is, oddly, they wouldn't have commercials showing clips from these shows. They would instead just show the poster for like 5 seconds, 5 or 10 seconds, and say, coming in the fall. And one of these illustrations was remarkable, unlike anything I'd ever seen before. It showed a planet with a very strange-looking spaceship rocketing around it with flame coming out the back and heads, portrait heads of some of the stars. And one of them was a very dashing young man, very handsome young man. But next, behind him, was another character who looked unlike anything I'd ever seen before. And because the thing was going so fast, I had to keep looking for it. This is before video recorders. You couldn't stop, you know, record a show and watch it again or slow it down or still frame it. You had to watch it when it came on, whenever it came on. And so I'd look for this commercial. And then there it was again. And I'd look closely. I'd sit as close as I could to the screen. And it was like, that guy in the back, he's kind of greenish, green-skinned. And are those pointed ears? My God, he has pointed ears. And then finally, and then the show was going to be coming. I thought, I've got to see this. I've got to see this show. And the first moment it debuted, the first moment that it aired, I was hooked. And it basically defined what has come since in my life. I mean, basically, if not for Star Trek, and of course it was Star Trek, there would be no Space Command. And what Gene Roddenberry stood for was defined and delineated in that first moment. But Gene Roddenberry was not the writer of that first moment. It was an episode called The Man Trap, and it was written by George Clayton Johnson. And it was a spectacular, wonderful episode. The basic plot was an alien, the last of its race, needs salt to live, and it is disguising itself as human beings to get that salt. But because it's not given salt, it has to kill people and draw the salt from their bodies. And remarkably, this is an episode where the Enterprise crew takes the wrong action, is in the wrong, because here's the last of a sentient species. And in disguise, it says, well, why don't we just give it, it's disguised as McCoy, it says, why don't we just give it salt? And they say, no, it's too dangerous, we've got to kill it. Well, you know, no, you've just got to give it salt. But, so the Enterprise wipes it out. But it was an amazing episode. It established Kirk and Spock and McCoy for the first time to the popular imagination, and it got things rolling. And it was thanks to George Clayton Johnson. Now that wasn't the first time he'd written about someone changing his appearance to blend in, his or her appearance to blend in, because before he wrote The Man Trap, he came up with the story for The Four of Us Are Dying, which was aired as a Twilight Zone episode about a man who can change his face. And it's no surprise that George wanted or fantasized about the power to imitate others, to not be noticed, because he had started life as an impoverished young man in Wyoming. His mother was an alcoholic. He came from mixed white and Indian background, and he said that, you know, with her, she, you know, there'd be times when there wouldn't be food in the house, she wouldn't notice those kind of things. So George was very eager for escape, and when he was young, he was bedridden for a time and just fantasized and read and dreamed of a different life. And as soon as he could, he made his way out here to L.A. and started working to become a writer. He came up with a story that was made into the movie Ocean's 11, and he fell in with Charles Beaumont, one of the great Twilight Zone writers, and his band of friends, John Tomerlin, William F. Nolan, and they would drive around and they would talk about writing and talk about life. These were all young men in their 20s and early 30s, and they were known as the group, and it was an incredible, fertile place where they were just full of life and full of dreams and able to express them in fantastical ways. And they loved science fiction. They loved many, many, many things. And over all of them, as sort of a patron saint, was Ray Bradbury, who was one of the great mentors of Charles Beaumont and also Richard Matheson. In fact, when Twilight Zone sold, Rod Serling called Ray Bradbury and said, "Educate me about science fiction." And he pointed Rod to two of his proteges, Charles Beaumont and Richard Matheson, and they became two of the great writers of the Twilight Zone. And through that, George had an entree to submit to Twilight Zone. But the fascinating story of this is that at one point, George was opining, and he had a lot of opinions, he was very talkative. He was opining to Charles Beaumont one night about his opinions, and at that point he'd sold a couple of short stories to Twilight Zone, but not scripts. And Beaumont said to him, "Look, George, if we're going to listen to you and respect you and you know, you think you are better than all of us and you have all of these opinions, but unless you can prove that you can write better than us, you know, or as well as us, we're not going to respect you." And so that put the fire under George to insist on getting a teleplay assignment, to insist on getting a script assignment on Twilight Zone. And here's the way that happened. George had written a story called Sea Change and sold it to Twilight Zone. And it was a very interesting and odd story about a man on a boat who loses his hand, and the hand grows back. But amazingly, the severed hand grows another body, and that's this monstrous creature that rampages and scares everyone and is on the ship. And it was this very weird story, and he sold it to Twilight Zone, and it was the only story that the sponsor, General Foods, rejected. And Buck Houghton came to George and said, "Mr. Johnson, I'm very, very sorry, but, would you be willing to buy this back? And because we can't use it." And George said to Buck Houghton, the producer of Twilight Zone, he said, "Only if the next time I have an idea that you want to buy, you let me write the teleplay." And so that was the deal. And then that worked really well. And George wrote a script for A Penny for Your Thoughts, which starred Dick York as a bank teller who gets the power to read minds. And it was a delightful comedic episode, but also with a point that people think things they'll never do and do things they're not thinking about, and that people are very curious creatures. Now, George told me later that he intended he had the idea for a series about someone getting this coin each week that allows them to read minds, different people. And he said the next episode would have been one where a guy gets the coin and he's a gambler, and he rises and rises, winning all these poker games because he can read the minds of the other players. And finally, he gets the top poker game, the great poker game, against the greatest poker player of all. And that poker player, when he sits down at the table to gamble, he sees that poker player is Chinese, and he thinks in Chinese. And so the guy can't read his mind. So really, really fun. Now, in terms of gambling, George actually came up with another story that wasn't credited to him. It was a story called The Prime Mover, about a guy who has the power to move objects with his mind, and he and his buddy go to Vegas to make a killing. And that was actually adapted. Charles Beaumont needed a story for Twilight Zone, didn't have a story, so he bought that story from George, and they just, by mistake, they forgot to credit George. Now, in the Twilight Zone Companion, I credit George, and so that's rectified. But it's another delightful episode. So after again after he did Twilight Zone, he then was invited along with Matheson and many of the other writers who'd worked on Twilight Zone to write for Star Trek, and just by the luck of the draw, he ended up getting the first episode that ever aired, which was The Man Trap, and was just wonderful. Now around about the same time, one of his other buddies, who drove with Beaumont, was William F. Nolan, another young hotshot and very ambitious writer, and they had this idea for a novel. Now back then, if you were writing science fiction novels, you might sell it for like $3,000 if you were lucky, maybe $1,000, and so those science fiction writers generally were very impoverished, and scraping by, maybe working other jobs to make a living, insurance salesmen, teachers, etc. But Bill Nolan had a great idea. He said, "Listen, George, let's do this. Let's aim higher. Let's write this book and sell it to a publisher who doesn't publish science fiction, a mainstream publisher, and set our goal to sell this to the movies, and our goal will be to sell it for $100,000. Now, this is, you know, the late 60s, and that's a huge sum of money. And so they said, "Okay, let's do it." Absolutely. So they sat down and furiously pounded out this novel, which was called Logan's Run. And it was about a future society. This was, again, written during the height of the hippie era. And it's about a future society where you live a glorious life until you turn 30 and your palm flower turns from red to black, this glowing thing in the palm of your hand. And then you're executed. Exterminated. And it was written with enormous vibrancy and inventiveness and fun, and very quickly, and reading it, it's a fun novel, not a great novel, but a very fun novel. And it was bought and adapted into a movie starring Michael York and Jenny Agutter. Quite a fun movie, but not a great movie either. And then it was made as a TV series. Now eventually, that I'm sure that book will be remade into probably a much better version. Bryan Singer's been trying for years to get it made. We'll see what happens. But it was a huge success for George and for Bill Nolan. And then things changed between them, and they kind of came to a parting of the ways creatively. But they agreed that they would each write their own sequels to Logan's Run. And Bill Nolan has written a number of sequels. George was working on a sequel for many years that didn't get published, but it was something he was laboring upon. Now, let's talk a little bit about George as a person, because I haven't talked about him much as a human being, but he was just, you would never forget him once you met him. And let me talk about him personally for a moment, because I mentioned that when I saw Twilight Zone, when I saw Star Trek, these left an indelible impression on me. And, the three shows that made me want to be a writer were Star Trek, Twilight Zone, and Outer Limits, the original versions of those three shows. So and my heroes watching those shows were not the actors, they were the writers. The people I wanted to meet were the writers, Harlan Ellison and Richard Matheson and Gene Roddenberry and D.C. Fontana and David Gerald and so forth. So as soon as I was old enough, I started going to science fiction conventions, and I love science fiction. I love the world of science fiction because you can meet your heroes, and you can go to these events. And my friend Fred Bronson, who later wrote for Star Trek The Next Generation, took me to my first science fiction convention, to a banquet at the World Science Fiction Convention, when I was, I think, 13. The first writer I ever saw at a convention was David Gerald, who wrote The Trouble with Tribbles, and ironically, actually went to college with my wife. But then I started going myself when I was around 16 years old, and they had great conventions. I grew up in L.A., and they had great science fiction conventions in San Diego, FilmCon and Equicon, and Bijo Trimble and her husband John Trimble were part of these conventions, and Bijo did the letter writing campaign that got Star Trek a third season. Some of you know that story. I'll do that. I'll talk about that story another time. But one of the first writers I met at one of these first conventions was George Clayton Johnson, and at the time, he must have been in his late 40s or early 50s, and he was dressed in bright, bright colors, bright oranges and yellows and reds, electric colors, and he had long gray hair, and sort of silver gray hair, or more like gunmetal, and he was clean shaven at that time. He had these high cheekbones and this big toothy grin, And just an amazing guy. And clearly, he was the 60s had been good to him. He was, a fan, very much a fan of the counterculture. Now, this is very interesting because when he wrote for Twilight Zone, that was before that period, and he smoked cigarettes and he had short hair. and would wear like a sport coat and looked very different from how he looked when I first met him. He was much more the beatnik type before the hippies came along. And then he was called the world's oldest hippie for many, many years. And but so when I met him, we struck up a friendship. Even though I was only 16, I was very interested in becoming a writer. And he was very, very encouraging. And the first book I ever wrote, although the first published book I wrote was The Twilight Zone Companion, the first book I ever wrote was in college. It was called Three Interviews on Media and Society. And I interviewed Theodore Sturgeon, the great Theodore Sturgeon, who also wrote for Star Trek and many other books and short stories. Ron Cobb, who was a designer on Alien and Aliens and Star Wars, and George Clayton Johnson. So I interviewed them and wrote prefatory introductions about them and included samples of their work. And it was a book-length publication. I had it bound as a hardcover. Someday I'll probably publish it just because it's a wonderful piece of work and very informative about these three amazing men. So George, so I did that when I was, I think, 19 or maybe, yeah, around 19. And then I got out of college, so I was 21 years old, and I knew I wanted to be a writer, producer in TV, and there were no classes in that. So I started thinking about, well, how do I learn this? And I started coming up with the idea of doing a book on the Twilight Zone. And George was the one I was talking to about this, and he was very, very encouraging. And one thing I should also mention is when Logan's Run came out, I think it came out around 1975, something like that, and so I took George, and MGM was still in existence. It's Sony Columbia TriStar now, but MGM was there, and they had one outside wall of the studio had this gigantic billboard of Logan's Run. And so George and I drove there, and I took photos of George standing by the gigantic letters of his name on that billboard, and which I'll include in the Twilight Zone Companion, the new edition. But it was just such a fun day, and he was thrilled to have his novel being made into a major motion picture. But now we go to me. I'm 22 years old, start writing The Twilight Zone Companion, and George was the first person I interviewed. And I knew I couldn't go to Carol Serling directly. I hadn't written any books other than that one I'd done as a college paper. I'd sold one short story. My degree was in art. But George allowed me to interview him, and then he connected me up with Jerry Sowell, another writer on The Twilight Zone, and Buck Houghton, the producer. And I started interviewing people, and I interviewed 30 people before I went to Carol Serling to see if she'd let me do the book. And I'd heard she'd already turned down major journalists. But George was so encouraging, and I talked to Carol, and she talked to people that she trusted, Buck Houghton, possibly George, and I got the go-ahead to do the book. And years later, it was many years later, in fact, last year, I saw George at the American Cinematheque, and I said to him, why did you encourage me? Why did you think I could pull this off? And he said, because I was just a kid, and he said, you were very, very intelligent and very determined, and I just had the feeling you could do it. And so, and thanks to him, I did. And over the years George grew a long beard, and I took more photos of him that appeared in books that he wrote. And he had this long beard they wore for decades, and long hair, and always in these electric colors, and always welcoming and kind to everyone, not just to me. And he was someone who was the great writer, a great writer. I mean, Kick the Can, I think, is one of the greatest pieces of writing ever done in television. Nothing in the Dark is superlative. I mean, these are scripts that are not only wonderfully, beautifully, poetically written. Kick the Can is just gorgeous, but also deeply profound about real life. And I realized, and something I learned from George Clayton Johnson and from Harlan Ellison, was that you could write one episode of one show, and it could change people's lives forever, and that we have a great responsibility as writers. And that's what I'm doing now with Space Command, of course. I believe in that as a great gift and a great possibility. But most writers, you know, just kind of waste people's time, and they write things that are about nothing. And that was certainly not true of George Clayton Johnson. Everything George wrote was meaningful. Everything George wrote was an exploration of the real world through a fantasy context. And he was the same. Every, you know, from when I first met him to when, you know, I last saw him, which was just a few months ago, he was the same bright spirit, the same delightful man, the same just full of ideas, full of warmth and compassion, a kind, incredibly kind. He never had a bad word to say about anyone. Just a fine person, and you know, and just someone who was always, you know, there to listen to people, to talk to people, and full of fun, full of delight. So this is sort of my piece about George Clayton Johnson. And I'm sure if you Google George Clayton Johnson, you can find video of him and you can see what I'm talking about. He was a remarkable man. And again, as with Bradbury, as with Harlan Ellison, as with so many of these brilliant, brilliant writers who were there at the right place at the right time, in the right circle to do their great work, once you met them, you'd never forget them. They were completely, totally unique. And I know you're not supposed to put a modifier before unique, but in this case, I think it's appropriate because I'm so blessed to have known George Clayton Johnson. I'm so blessed to have experienced his work. I think Kick the Can, he wrote Kick the Can when he was in his 20s. I think it's the best thing ever written about old age and needing to be young again and stay young in spirit. And George exemplified that in his life and in his work. And I think if you want to be wonderfully entertained and deeply moved, just go watch Kick the Can again. And he wrote about death in Nothing in the Dark, which was inspired by a story that Ray Bradbury wrote called Death of the Maiden, but is better than Death of the Maiden. And also, if you want to hear George talk about his work, I made sure that all of his four great Twilight Zone episodes, that we did audio commentaries with George about them. So if you go to the Blu-ray, you can hear George talking with me about those entire episodes and everything behind them and how he originated them. And I'm so glad that I made it a point to get him on the record talking about his work. So he lives in my heart. We had a memorial for him the other day at the American Cinematheque with William F. Nolan, his great collaborator and friend, and others who were touched by him and moved by him, and an audience that was able to share our memories and watch his great work again on the big screen. So that's it for now. Feel free to like and spread the word about Mr. Sci-Fi. Much more to come in the near future. I'll be posting a number more of these videos very soon. And thanks, and we'll talk again. Bye-bye.